So yeah, I have the pleasure of introducing Bruce Laurie. So Bruce is the president of the Ivy Foundation, which is a private charitable foundation in Canada. And he's also a director of the Clean Economy Fund and Canadians for Clean Prosperity. But you'd probably best know Bruce because he was a director at the ISO and formerly over at the OPA. So Bruce also sits on the advisory boards of Canada's Eco-Fiscal Commission and the Canadian Energy Research Institute, and founded a number of profit and non-profit organizations in Canada. But in Bruce, in 2015, Bruce received the Brighton Award for Outstanding Achievement, and that's York University's highest recognition, also the Earth Day Canada Award for Outstanding Commitment to the Environment. But finally, Bruce has written a couple of books. So a best-selling book, Slow Death by Rubber Duck, and he's got another one here, Talks In, Talks Out. So we're going to actually be, these are going to be two of the raffle prizes at the end. But I would like to welcome Bruce.
Schneider for having me here today. It's a real pleasure. I kind of moonlight on the toxic chemical side, but energy and electricity is really what I've mostly worked on for the last 25 years or so. So I'm going to step back a little bit and look at what is the context in which we're all working in the energy and electricity sector. And you know, it's very easy to burrow down into the weeds in our everyday work. But I thought I would give you a real sense of like what's actually going on in the heads of politicians, what's going on in the heads of some of the senior people around the world that are kind of grappling with energy and electricity within the broader context of sustainability. And I think the opening remarks from I'm assuming that was the Schneider CEO, around the challenge of climate change, I think are a good setup for this. So I'm going to do just a quick intro to broader sustainability and where we're at. So really, the concept of sustainable development came about with this seminal report called Our Common Future, written by, or chaired by Gro Harlem Brundtland, the Danish sustainability leader. And it really brought together this idea that sustainability is combining the ecology, economy, and society. That was 30 years ago. So where are we 30 years later? So we can see that we're on track for global warming of around 3 to 4 degrees. You know, there's different, of course, everyone will be well aware of different IPCC scenarios, but without quite dramatic action, the likelihood is we're going to see considerable warming around the world. In terms of other issues, I mean, what evidence of that? We're seeing the polar ice caps melting. I'm sure all of you have seen and heard these statistics. The hurricanes that we're seeing and, flood levels. This is a map that shows what Florida might look like in 2100. Where more than half of the value of the land of Florida will be under a meter of water. This, although I used this last time I was speaking in California a year ago and flying into LA and the hills were on fire, and of course this year we've got Napa on fire, so we're gonna see more dramatic events like this. A stat that I dug out the other day, which I was amazed at, the 8 out of the 10 largest insurance claims in Canadian history were in the last 10 years, and 7 of those 8 insurance claims were weather-related in Alberta, 7 out of the 8. Species extinction, another whole side of the sustainability biodiversity, but you can see there species extinction and human populations tracking pretty closely. The collapse of global fisheries, we're not really doing a great job. Canada actually has the global distinction of mismanaging what was considered to be the largest fish resource on the planet, which is the Atlantic cod fishery, still hasn't recovered. And then of course there's the social side of sustainability, which is looking at income inequality. And we've all heard of the 99% versus the 1%, which is the graph on your left. What to me is even more amazing is you look at the 0.01% against the 1%, and the 1% are flat. So it's the super rich that are becoming super richer, and I think the stat I saw was that the 80 richest people in the world have more wealth than the 1 billion poorest. So it's and I think this is, I was just at this two-day think tank thing in Oxford last week, and what amazed me was that the single biggest issue that people saw right now facing us globally was the ability for people who feel that they're or are, you know, legitimately in the 99% or the 99.9%, their ability to use things like Facebook to mobilize and really disrupt global political systems. So we get Trump, we get Brexit, we get the rise of the far right in France and Germany, and so it hadn't occurred to me that it was that blatant, and what basically they were calling for was the need to actually regulate the way these social media sites are functioning. So the question that I've always wondered, so given basically what we know, why don't we act differently? And so, you know, some of the things we do, you know, we try to present solid scientific evidence, and we try to present solid economic evidence, but still we're on this track for 3 to 4 degree warming. So that's kind of the background and the context for why people like politicians get interested in the Green Energy Act or sustainability or carbon pricing. It's because they're part of this global conversation. And you know, the answer probably in the late 90s and 2000s was the idea of corporate social responsibility. But I think when McKinsey is saying that corporate social responsibility isn't working, then I think we know that we have a challenge before us. So now I'm going to turn a little bit to what I'm supposed to be talking about, which is the history of electricity. And of course, we all have our own experiences, our own backgrounds, our own biases, and you will certainly see my perspective in this. But I thought I would just look back, and this was, and you'll see where I'm going with this in a minute in terms of where we're at with our pricing. But the challenge that we really have with electricity is that it's like, unlike the price of cars, unlike the price of coffee, even the price of oil, politicians, because the electricity system is largely government controlled and political, politicians can't help trying to make it better or suit their own ideological views. So going back into the 70s, the decision was made to build Darlington. It ended up being 10 years late and $12 billion over budget. That kind of left us with 30 years of debt payments that got built into the system over that 30 years. And that was something that was first, it was approved initially by the conservative government of Bill Davis. Oops, I have Davies there, Bill Davis. And then, of course, it was the Peterson government that ended up building it. And then, you know, that things didn't go well for the Liberals. Electricity was part of the conversation. Bob Rae got elected. And then in 1993, we had one of our more significant recessions. Everyone started getting concerned about the increase in electricity rates at the time. And so what the NDP did was freeze electricity rates. And basically, when you cap electricity rates, that means ultimately you're capping the new expenditures and infrastructure improvements. So at the end of the Bob Rae reign, lots of people weren't so happy. Electricity also played a part of that political conversation. And then Mike Harris and the Conservatives promise that they are going to fix the electricity system, they are going to lower electricity rates, and that they're going to do it through the free market. So what happens, I was actually way back then, I was on the, it was called the Electricity Transition Committee that Mike Harris formed with Energy Minister Jim Wilson. And it was really a fascinating experience just seeing how all of that unfolded with the minister who was at all of the meetings chairing them, and actually David McFadden is at all of the meetings, many of you may know. And so most of the people in the sector, there were representatives from Hydro One and OPG and Enbridge, all very senior, like chairs of boards, CEOs, president of Enbridge. And basically everyone's saying, well, you can't just open up the market and expect electricity prices will go down magically. Like it was, if you looked at the kind of the 101 economics, Ontario had lower electricity prices than any of the jurisdictions around us. Prices had been artificially suppressed for over 6 years. There was no investment in the system, and the system needed investment. So guess what happens? The market opens, electricity prices spiked, like hugely when they opened it, because they opened the market in June or something, which wasn't a great time. So at that point, Ernie Eves was running the province. And of course, everyone freaked out. Electricity prices spiked. All of the same industry associations that were pushing for competition now suddenly were pushing for a regulated cap. And so what did Ernie Eves do? He capped electricity prices. All the businesses, maybe some of you I'm sure would have been involved. I remember a good friend of mine, you guys all know Adam White, was working for TransAlta, and all these companies from Alberta were here. They were going to build up the electricity system in Ontario. It was going to be a free market. Everything was going to be great. And electricity rates got capped at like 4.3 cents or something, and then suddenly, boom, all shut down, everyone left, no more investment. So that turns us to, what put the exact date in, McGinty, 2003, something like that, no, five, anyway. So people are unhappy with the current government, which is, you know, not an uncommon cycle. Dalton McGuinty gets elected, and the Liberals promise to fix the broken electricity system. And what the Liberals realized at that point when they got elected is Ontario was about to face brownouts in the coming summer. There simply wasn't enough supply to meet the demand. And they realized that because the system now was this sort of funny hybrid, part market-based, part regulated, that they needed to create the structures to actually build out the infrastructure that had been essentially for 20 years not built out in Ontario. And so what they did was create the Ontario Power Authority as a way to very quickly start doing planning, which had seemed to have dropped off the agenda, do some forward-looking electricity planning, and also build some quick gas power plants to fill the demand gap and prevent brownouts that were predicted. And which is really what the primary mandate was of the OPA when it was first formed. So, speaking of shutting down coal, so one of the things that that the government also had committed to, and people forget now, back then, I was very involved in the campaign to phase out coal-fired power plants in Ontario. And at the time, the Conservatives, the Liberals, and the NDP all committed to phase out coal. And people kind of forget that now, and I'm sure Patrick Brown would probably not even acknowledge that the Conservatives had agreed to that. But the result of the coal phase-out was quite significant. So you could look at projections of greenhouse gas emissions in actual reductions in Ontario and versus, say, Alberta, and that helps explain part of the political dynamic in Canada around this issue and the challenge that the federal government has in trying to manage their greenhouse gases. And one of the things that I remember vividly back then is people were saying, well, even if you close the coal plants in Ontario, it's going to have no effect on air quality in southern Ontario. It's all the cars, it's all the pollution from the U.S. And certainly there's been other factors outside of coal plants, but the reality is we were seeing, you know, anywhere from 5 to 53 smog advisory days in southern Ontario while the coal plants were running, and as they phased out, you can see in 2013 the last coal plant was closed and there were no, in 14, 15, and 16, zero smog advisories in southern Ontario. So I'll admit it's not entirely due to coal, but it's a very strong correlation, and certainly a large part of it is due to the removal of coal. And what other people don't really remember as well is, so if you look at our various power plants that we had at the time, You can see Lakeview, that's like a 1961 Chevy. Pickering's, I think, a 77. You know, Lambton, I think, is a 79. And Bruce, which is our modern power plant, that's actually the exact Chevrolet Caprice Classic that we had when I was in high school. So these power plants aren't exactly, you know, modern. And part of the analysis of the coal phase out was that most of these were beyond their extended life plan. They'd been paid off, they were old power plants, and they had to be replaced. It's part of the whole assessment that was done, you know, when the when the governments were looking at what were the options going forward. And so these things had to be replaced. And as you know, if you're driving a 1977 Impala that cost you $3,500 and you want to replace it with a 2017 Impala or Prius or whatever, you're going to be paying $30,000. So that really, in large measure, explains why the electricity prices rose, because we replaced a whole bunch of old, paid-off power plants with brand new, shiny things like gas plants and wind turbines. And of course, a lot of that stuff was more in the Tesla range of the market than the Chevy range. But it had to be replaced regardless. Now, speaking of forecasts, so I first started working on energy issues 25 years ago, which seems like a long time ago. I guess it was. And many of you will remember the demand supply plan that Ontario Hydro put together in 1990-ish, and was the subject of a major environmental assessment hearing, the demand supply plan environmental assessment review. And I thought, so that was 25 years ago, it'd be kind of fun to look at where is the electricity demand today and what were the electricity forecasts 25 years ago. And you can see the very top line was the, what's called, it says DSP up, or the demand supply plan, upper forecast, and the two lines, the median forecast, and then two lines down is the lower forecast. So the forecast that was considered to be the lowest economic growth and energy demand, electricity demand forecast for Ontario is actually five Pickering nuclear generating stations above where we actually are today. And that's not to say that, you know, forecasters were all completely out to lunch. Every other forecaster out there was like that. People were expecting unprecedented economic growth, and they didn't factor in energy efficiency. So those are the two, and then of course, some significant structural changes to the Ontario economy, the loss of manufacturing, and the decline of the pulp and paper industry being two major factors. But I thought what's interesting too, even if you look at the IMO, I remember the independent market operator, the IMO forecasts that came in, kind of say, 10 years ago, they basically tracked off on that similar trajectory. And we just did a workshop actually last week on energy data modeling. We had some of the top energy data modelers in the country together, you know, government, private sector, academic modelers. And the one thing that hadn't dawned on me was that, and everyone was talking about why forecasts are always wrong. And not only always wrong, but they're always high. Forecasts are always too high. And the reason is twofold. There is an optimistic sense of economic growth, threefold. There's an optimistic sense of economic growth. There is also a bias, which hadn't occurred to me, where modelers that are doing work for governments aren't allowed to put in assumptions that aren't consistent with government assumptions. And government assumptions are always unrealistically optimistic. So we have this kind of ridiculous feedback loop where people are knowingly using the wrong numbers because the politicians are telling them those are the numbers you have to use. So it partly explains why these are wildly inaccurate. And then of course, the other thing that the modelers discovered is that it is impossible to model in disruption. So there's no way, like if you look at the forecasts recently that are out there on, that look at sort of the future of the energy system and energy system models, They all got the massive decline in solar panel prices wrong. They all got the massive decline in wind prices wrong. No one could have imagined the disruption of those kinds of technologies. So anyway, I haven't done a lot of work in this, but we have been recently at the Ivy Foundation, and it's just really fascinating. But what it does is, for those who are working in the sector, if you think that these are actually the smartest people in the country, using data that they think is the best data in the country to create a forecast about what the future is going to look like, that's not the case. That's not actually happening. So let's take a look at green energy. I'm sure you're all aware of the Green Energy Act. It's always, you know, fun at a party to talk about the Green Energy Act and see where people land on it. and I'll have to say, I like to think I'm reasonably balanced. A lot of stuff went wrong, but things did go right. And it's what I call the government approach. So the minister dictates a plan. You may all remember George Smitherman, and literally dictated a plan. And there were elements of that that made a lot of sense. There's no way that the Ontario government would have become a global leader in reducing greenhouse gases, bring in all kinds of innovation around the adoption of solar, biomass, biogas, wind, et cetera, if it wasn't for the drive of George Smitherman. The problem is, it would have been implemented in a much better way had those who were working in the bureaucracy and those who were working at the OPA and those who were working in all of your industries been involved, if it wasn't for the drive of George Smitherman. So a lot of things, again, were knowingly put in place that made no sense in terms of the way contracts were done, and that put more cost in the system than was needed to be put in the system. But at the end of the day, I think it was fundamentally the right idea and the right direction, but the implementation was just super challenging. And I'd be happy to talk to anybody about that. I was fairly active on both seeing it unfold and seeing it implemented. And this I have to, if this actually ends up being public, I have to put a source notation in this. This is from my friend Greg Lyle. Greg Lyle is one of the top energy opinion researchers. Has he spoken here? Greg Lyle, super guy. He basically does, his business largely does opinion research on energy issues in Canada. So, again, if you try to think, why are politicians doing something that, you know, many of us now would think makes no sense? And the reason they're doing it is because 82% of Ontario supported the Green Energy Plan. 82% of Ontario thought it made sense to be more sustainable, to reduce greenhouse gases, reduce air pollution, and make the system, conservation and meet new demand in that way. The problem always is, but no one wants to pay for it. So everyone wants a better world, but they don't want to have to pay for a better world. And I think, my only comment here, I think the 5% annual increase number, of course the majority oppose that, and that's also higher than the actual annual increase. I suppose it's around there, but it is challenging when you have to change a system, make it all new, and then expect it isn't going to cost any more. But at the end of the day, you know, really, like, why is it in Canada that Quebec and Manitoba have super low electricity rates? You know, is it the clever politicians? Is it the brilliant utility managers? No, obviously not. It's the massive low-cost hydro resources that they have. And I won't read all of this, but unless you understand what the actual resource makeup of in your jurisdiction is and what the economic structure of your jurisdiction is, you won't understand what the electricity prices are. So this, I think maybe Eric, this is what clued you into inviting me to come today. So I wrote an op-ed in the Toronto Star on February 23rd of this year, and in it I said, any politician who promises low electricity rates is selling a lie. 4 days later, NDP leader Horvath says she can chop electricity rates by 30%. And 3 days after that, Premier Kathleen Wynne says she can slash electricity rates by 25%. So the point I made in the article is, well, they can't actually reduce electricity rates, or they might be able to reduce electricity rates, but they can't reduce the cost of the electricity system. We've paid for it. All they're doing is shifting cost into the tax base out of the ratepayer base. And of course, just even driving here this morning, there was a story on the CBC with exactly that point. And of course, Horvath all over it, you know, saying this is crazy, when meanwhile she wants to do it even more than Kathleen Wynne. So we have a real problem with politicians not understanding this, meddling with the system, and basically, frankly, creating even more dissent among the public, because someone reading this is going to think, oh yeah, right, why isn't our premier reducing electricity rates by 25%? It's like, well, how about coffee? How about my car? How about oil? How about, you know, dinner in restaurants? Like, it's just a ridiculous notion. And then, this is the other thing, I mean, how many times have you heard on the radio that Ontario has the highest electricity rates in North America? I hear that all the time. And, you know, I go a bit nuts. So let's just look at what electricity is, what's happening with electricity in a global context. So even in the US, where, you know, a lot of the electricity is in private markets, you know, not all for sure, but much of it, there's been on average an 86% increase in electricity rates in the US since 2001. New York City pays 21 cents a kilowatt hour for electricity. Australia, 36, Germany, 40, Denmark, 50. I just yesterday looked at my electricity rate. I was curious. So I took a blended rate across the three, I live in downtown Toronto, a blended rate across my three high peak, mid peak, low peak. And I pay 0.084 cents a kilowatt hour. 40% of that is the actual electricity, and 60% of that is delivery. So how in the world can we be complaining about our electricity rates relative to the rest of the world? I mean, sure, Quebec pays 3 or 4 or 5, whatever it is, Manitoba's 5 or 6, BC's 6, 7. But we're an anomaly globally. We have the lowest electricity rates in the world. And the challenge globally when it comes to electricity is what I call this electricity trilemma. So we want it to be clean, we want it to be affordable, and we want it to be reliable. And in the middle is the the Goldilocks porridge. It's just right. And it's hard to get it just right. But let's think about where Canada's at, where Ontario is at right now. We probably have close to the most reliable electricity in the world. We have almost certainly the cleanest electricity in the world, and we have the most affordable electricity in the world. So, you know, we talk about, you know, Toronto, Ontario, you know, being world class. We are world class in our electricity system, but we're also world class whiners when it comes to the cost of electricity. It's completely, completely misguided. So, where are we going in terms of the future of electricity? And this, so I call the electricity imperative. We know fossil fuels are decreasing generally in a trend going forward. Electricity use is increasing. I mean, essentially, the economy will be electrified. And what we need to do is, as the economy electrifies, we decarbonize electricity. That's basically the plan when it comes to energy systems transition. And it's going to be the largest economic transition that the world has seen since the Industrial Revolution. And the great news is, all of us, especially more than anyone, you guys in this, guys and girls in this room, can shape that. So I won't go into this. It's pretty obvious the massive reductions we've seen in solar and wind. I just saw a presentation a couple weeks ago, and they built a wind project in I think it was in Mexico, and I was like, it came in at 3.9 cents or something. I don't know if you've seen now, they've got 8 megawatt towers. Like, these, it's just completely unbelievable. But I actually think solar is going to be the future. I think we're going to see more solar than wind as those costs continue to decline. You look at, you know, pretty credible groups like Bloomberg, and this was really fascinating. So the idea here is, at what point do electric vehicles replace as much oil as a recession? Yes. and cause so much disruption that the oil price collapses, and when is that going to happen?
Yeah.
And they're looking at anywhere from kind of 2023 to the 2025 range. So that's, we're talking 6-8 years where electric cars will basically cause oil prices to collapse globally. You know, speaking of the disruption, actually, it's funny, I was speaking at an event that was the Institute of Corporate Directors a few weeks ago on directors' fiduciary responsibility and carbon risk. And someone asked a question in the room. It had one of the rooms with most clickers, everyone can vote. And you had to vote on what you saw as the biggest issue facing corporate directors in Canada. 87% said disruption, 3% said climate change. And so I'm sitting there going, okay, so is climate change not disruption, or is disruption not climate change? Anyway, it all depends on how you frame it. So look at Tesla, a market capitalization of $50 billion. They sold 84,000 cars. General Motors, market capitalization, $50 billion. They sold 10 million cars. So what that means is people are betting the future on Tesla. They're not betting the future on General Motors. Although General Motors is, they have a little uptick, I think, in the last quarter. But partly because they're now, you know, they've all now committed to electric cars. So we're going to see massive disruption, I think, at a level that people just aren't yet quite ready for. Here, this is a couple of years ago, and more charging points in Japan than there are gas stations. Who's thinking of that in this country? This is the whole move toward, which I think the Schneider presentation really spoke to, is this, you know, this idea of disintermediation, where you're basically putting all of the technologies in the hands of people and creating this, what's called, you know, sort of peer-to-peer economy, where you're using Airbnb, you're not owning a car, and you're using one of the many different car services that are out there. And this is changing the structure of the economy significantly and disrupting it. And I'll just run through these quickly. So the other piece that I really like to make a strong point of is, again, if you look at the future energy system models globally, every single one of them has energy efficiency as the most important thing that needs to be done. And not only that, most of you see, McKinsey did these famous cost curves that showed investments in reducing greenhouse gases. All of the energy efficiency investments are positive investments, so you basically save money over time with energy efficiency. And then as the curve trails out, you start getting into the more expensive costs, like building out large hydro or large nuclear. So energy efficiency now, I think, without exception, is considered to be the most important investment. And one of the challenges too with electricity is, even though we all know, as I showed with the 1969 Chevrolets, that when we build these systems, they last a long time, the decision making politically is always over a very short period of time. So you'll have politicians now, it's happening in fact in Ontario right now, it's happening in BC right now, saying, why would we be investing in energy efficiency? We have too much demand. We should just get rid of energy efficiency. Well, you get rid of energy efficiency, and in 5 years, you have no capacity to do energy efficiency when you actually need it. So you actually have to retain and build in energy efficiency as part of the system, knowing that it's needed throughout, and it's needed for the long term, and it's going to be needed much more than it is today. Just more on energy efficiency. So, I think the other piece that is going to be, and again, you would all, I think, be aware of these trends, but the idea that we're starting to see a shift from what we've had historically as passive electricity users to engaged electricity users. So, I've been working in this field for a long time, and I bought this little rundown log cabin in northern Ontario, and it had no electricity and no running water, and I thought, oh, that's fun, I'll just start from scratch and see what I can do. So, you know, now it's PV electricity and solar hot water, it all runs amazingly well. There's all kinds of storms up there, the power goes out every 2 weeks on the lake, I always have power. And it's so I turn on the lights when everyone else is out of power, just to make a point. But I honestly didn't think it was going to be as easy as it was, and I didn't think it would work as well as it did, and I didn't think it would be as cheap as it was. And even one example for me, I have six panels. Like, it's not a big system at all, like a kilowatt. The first three panels I bought were $750 each. They're very nice Japanese panels. And 3 years later, I added three more. They were $250 each, the exact same panel, 20% more efficiency. Like, it's sort of unbelievable. And because I was starting from scratch, literally there was no lights, no electricity, nothing. So all LED lighting, the local electrician that I used said, oh geez, you don't want LED lights, those things don't work. And then, I said, no. So put them all in, and he couldn't believe it. And then at the end of it, he said, well, this is amazing. He said, you've got, four buildings, lights in all the buildings. I added them all up. Every single light you have is less than 100 watts. And it can be done. It's not that hard to imagine a society where we're using, say, anywhere from 20 to, 20 being exceptional to 40% of the electricity that we're using today, and getting the exact same quality of life and product out of that. So I think as these technologies become even more rapid, as they become more connected, as people get more into it, as more young people are participating in the purchase of these products, I think we're going to see a rapid acceleration of these technologies. And I think the Schneider presentation gave a sense of how their technologies will be supporting this. The one point I've done a fair bit of media on, what do we do about electricity prices, and what did I think of Kathleen Wynne and Horvath suggesting that they're going to lower our electricity prices. And really what I think we need to stop doing is subsidizing everybody. When most of us that live in large urban centers, electricity is a tiny, tiny portion of our overall annual budget. And so if my electricity rate goes up 5% or down 5%, it doesn't affect me. But if somebody is living in a community that has no options, that has no, where they have poor housing, low income, and not a lot of alternatives, that's where the resources should go. So we shouldn't be subsidizing the entire system. We should be supporting the people who need it most, and making sure that their quality of life, their homes, are adequate. So I just don't know why governments aren't thinking more in that way. Going forward, I think really what we're seeing is the need for everybody in businesses, whether you're working in LDCs or in government or in suppliers, is this idea of being more engaged and more responsible around these issues, accepting that change is not only necessary, but change is happening. I think we're seeing that we're clearly in the midst of this big structural change, and I think it's much more productive for people to be embracing and supporting change as opposed to digging in and resisting. And part of that means finding constructive allies, it means understanding disruptive business markets, and really shifting our perspective so that, we're not just thinking of a company in and of itself, but a company that's part of a bigger sector, that's part of society, and a more kind of inclusive. I work for a foundation, so we have to talk about this stuff. Genuinely, I think this is really the way we have to think about this. And often people sit back and think, policy is something that happens to them, but more and more, I think, as people get engaged, policy, I think, will become more something that, people in the sector are informing, and really we need that to get out of this kind of crazy broken system of politicians flip-flopping and thinking that they know how to run an electricity system. So, I'm going to close now or in a second. Today's electricity system, as we've seen, is the result of 50 years of choices, and they may not all be the choices that we would have made, but we were part of the choices that were made, And I think now we're in the process of making the choices that are going to affect the next 50 years of the system. And so I just really encourage everyone to think about the choices that you make in your daily work. And this is always one of my favorite climate slides. And with that, I'll just thank you.
Situation where our clients in the commercial sector or me as an individual, because energy cost isn't a big part of our decision making, there need to be other ways or other exterior motivations to do that. So which ones do you think are, or where should we be focusing as a government or in policy or as an individual, where should we be looking to have those other motivations? What are the important ones?
Well, yeah, so certainly, I mean, the big challenge with energy efficiency is sort of distributed benefit, right, and distributed cost. So unlike a lot of projects where, you know, building a gas plant, it's kind of clear to see who gets the benefit when it's constructed. So I think with energy efficiency, you have to basically package up, you know, package up the whole value proposition of energy efficiency. So who's saving money, who's having a higher value building at the end of the day, who's benefiting from better air quality and comfort in the building, and really look at things that go beyond the actual cost, because the cost gets distributed across all of these different beneficiaries, and so any one of them look at it. So I mean, a commercial building, as you know, the classic, right, you've got the architect, the engineers, the owners, the tenants, the managers, like they all, there isn't enough benefit for all any one of them to see the value in investing in energy efficiency. So I think it's important that is all packaged and figure out who is getting which benefits and highlight those for those individuals. And the one that I think gets missed out in energy efficiency at the end of the day is in buildings in particular, is really the, you're getting a better quality building with higher resale value and more comfort for people living in the building. And you know, I remember this little anecdote. My company actually ran the R2000 program years and years ago, and we were sort of trying to reconfigure it as a market-based program, not a giant government subsidy program. And so we said, okay, well, we're going to talk about all those things: comfort and resale value and quality. And the government said, well, no, this is a climate change program. You have to talk about climate change. Well, man, people don't buy a house to save climate, right? They buy a house to live in. And anyway, so those kinds of sort of nutty things go on, but you have to realize that what do people really care about, and then talk about that. Yeah. And the other one I was talking about, the other one is the finance piece too, of course. If you can create ways that, we're doing a project right now where we're trying to figure out, you know, how do you de-risk a longer-term energy efficiency investment and get a deeper efficiency out of the project, and that often means bringing in different kinds of capital, some that is willing to, you know, de-risk it for the private sector.
Thank you.
I think at the end of the day, it's really very specific to the region and the resources in the region. And I would say, if you're asking me to predict what do I think will dominate the future of electricity, I think it will be solar. I think that's going to be the big winner down the road. Just looking right now at the cost curves for solar, let's say, solar, wind, nuclear, large hydro is obviously so site-specific. I mean, we'll still have some large hydro, but in Canada. But if you look at those cost curves, nuclear isn't really coming down. Wind is quite a bit, and solar is, you know, just plummeting. So I really think the future is going to be largely solar. But if you look, again, if you look at the energy modeling, the energy systems modeling for how we have to achieve the greenhouse gas commitments, say, of Paris, it's everything. Like, it isn't, you don't pick, it's not, this is what sort of drives me nuts about people who say, oh, well, we're going to do more of this or more of this or this. It's actually more of every low carbon source as possible while reducing or increasing efficiency by 50%. Like, that's the plan, which, but we're not quite on the plan yet.
Bruce, enjoyed your talk. Short-term prediction. You've made a lot of your history of what's happened in the marketplace very accurate. Your crystal ball, what does it say about energy efficiency if there's a changing government? We have had a history of conservation disappearing with a new government. Is this a real risk, or is it, what's your thoughts?
I think it's a real risk. Probably not, it's not very popular to predict elections, but I'm going to guess we have a switch in government. I think it's a risk, and I think it's important for anyone who believes in energy efficiency and recognizes how critical energy efficiency is to managing the energy system going forward, that, you know, they make their voices clear. We're Scott, you'll remember the Energy Efficiency Alliance that we were working on years ago. There's actually a process underway right now to revitalize a national voice around energy efficiency. And it's a combination of, you know, recognizing its increasing importance, you know, as I said, in those, all of those long-term energy models, and also recognizing that there isn't really a strong voice supporting energy efficiency in Canada right now. So I think anyone that is in this business or believes that this is important for their energy system planning needs to make their voices heard. Because the governments write it off, like conservative governments typically write it off as some environmental thing, and they don't really understand how critical it is to keeping costs down and managing the system going forward. So I think it's a real risk, Scott.
There you go.
Time
for one more question? Yeah, here.
So I'll just quickly think, so why is it so low? I think Ontario has done a reasonably good job of managing the electricity system, and we have access to resources that, you know, the nuclear stuff is running quite well and comes in at a super low cost, and some of the hydro stuff is as well, so that's, I mean, technically why it's low. In terms of subsidy, my point was that both the NDP and the Liberals are saying they're going to reduce electricity rates by 25 or 30%. The Conservatives haven't yet, as far as I know, said anything. So the point is there, what that means is they will be subsidizing everybody in Ontario. And my point is most of the people in Ontario don't need a subsidy, but some people need a really significant subsidy. So rather than give a little bit of money to a whole lot of people, most of whom don't need it, why don't we, and when I say subsidy, we should be going into communities, particularly Indigenous communities in Ontario, and rebuilding all of the housing stock to a quality that is a livable quality that Canadians would think is So that would be a lot, that would be a subsidy, but you could probably do it with the amount of money that's going to subsidize the entire system. And, you know, I would argue that several million people in Ontario just simply don't need a subsidy, whereas maybe several tens of thousands need a really huge subsidy. So I'm not talking about, yeah, I'm not a big fan of subsidies, but if you're going to mess with the system, do it intelligently.
That's a good way to end. All right, and this room is going to remain open, so you're going to be hanging around for questions. I haven't seen Tim Christie around here from the MOE, but he'll get the final word when he presents in about half an hour or so in one of the rooms over there. So thank you very much, and enjoy the rest of the
Great, thank you.